like when they were a kid. Okay, a little bit more of a reaction. Who is still afraid of the dark? It's a safe place. We're going to pray later. Amen. So, I think I am too, because I don't know what is up with the dark, like literally. I mean, when I was a kid, I want you to imagine right now your bedroom when you were a child. I want you to imagine what color the walls were. I want you to imagine, you know, what duvet cover you had on. Was it a Buzz Lightyear duvet cover? Was it a, you know, My Little Pony? Paul says yes. Duvet cover. What were your posters like? Do you remember your wardrobe? Do you remember the furniture that you had in your room? I mean, my room was like a haven. It was an oasis. It was where I went to do my study, and where I went to, you know, sleep, and it was where I listened to my music, and it's where I did my workouts. I did my workouts in my bedroom, and it was my room. It was mine. It was my oasis. But when the sun goes down, there is something that happens to this friendly, warm, loving environment. And all of a sudden, it turns sinister. Anybody? I mean, it's like every nook and cranny, every corner that has a bit of a shadow. Well, in the day, they were just corners and nooks and crannies and something that you don't even think about. But in the dark, you don't know what's in those. You don't know what's in that corner. You don't know what's in that little, you don't know what's under your bed. Did anybody else do this? Well, where I was switching off the light, my light switch for my bedroom was on the other side of the room to my bed. And did anybody else sort of like size up the distance between the light switch and the bed, and then you flick it off, and then you bolt, you kind of run, and then you pick your spot where you're going to jump, and you leap out onto your bed. Now, why do we do that? Anyone? What was that? Monster under the bed. The monster wasn't there in the day, but in the nighttime, definitely there. You get too close to the bed, what's going to happen? It's going to be like, hands are going to come out. Did anybody else do that? It was just me. What is up with the dark? You see, the dark isn't like the absence of light. You know, it's like, oh, you know, there's just no light and there is no change. No, the darkness feels different. Like it literally has a presence. It's like somebody is here watching me in the dark. Things are looming. Things are like something's coming out of my cupboard or something's coming out of my wardrobe. You don't go to sleep with your wardrobe doors slightly ajar. No, 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 no. Even if the catch is not working, you shove something against that door to keep it closed because, you know, monsters can't push cushions. But it all makes sense to you at the time. What is up with the dark? It feels like it's got a presence. It feels like it's got weight to it. It's like it presses in on you. It's like your breathing starts to change. You know, before you were nice and relaxed, but now your breathing's a little bit more challenged. Now you're kind of looking over your shoulder. You're looking in the corners. You're looking everywhere. What is up with the dark? I want to talk to you about dark times. You see, as Christians, those of us who have chosen to put our trust in Jesus, who know that He is our Lord and our Savior, that He died on a cross for our sins, guess what? We go through dark times. Anybody? Or are we just tiptoeing through the tulips? Oh, is that what we're telling the world? Come to Jesus and you will be tiptoeing through the tulips. Well, I can tell you now that I have bought lots of tulips and I've done a bit of tiptoeing, but I've still gone through my dark times. Let me describe maybe some dark times. Bereavement, the loss of a loved one. What about betrayal? Anybody done you wrong? What about sickness? What about financial strife? I mean, the list can be endless, but if you want to know what dark times perhaps you are walking through right now, just close your eyes for a moment. Just for a moment, let me ask you a quick question. Where's the fear? Where is the fear? Where are the things that you're worried about? Where is the shame? Where are the things that you pray and work really hard that nobody else sees? What makes you feel small? What makes you feel disqualified? Wherever that is, you can open your eyes now. That is the darkness. Where is the fear? Even as Christians, we can all walk through dark times. But you see, I know that the enemy has an agenda with suffering. Whenever we are suffering through something, I know that the enemy's got an agenda. It's very clear. Jesus told us in John 10, he said, the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. You see, the enemy has an agenda through whatever that you are walking through. And what he wants you to be afraid, number one, he wants you to feel powerless. He wants you to feel disqualified. He wants you to feel like you've got nothing to contribute. He wants to keep you contained and quiet. Perhaps even overwhelmed. Because how many of us know that sometimes when we walk through challenge, when we walk through suffering, it's not just hard, but it's overwhelming. Because we can't see. It is horrible when you can't see. You don't know where to go. You don't know which way is the way out. You've got no means of helping yourself because you're in the dark. But we know that the enemy has an agenda. But I want to know, is that it? Like literally, is that it? Everybody goes through hard times, just suck it up. Or everybody goes through hard times, you just hang in there for as long as you can. Until maybe, just maybe, Jesus will be kind, snap his fingers, and it will all go away. Is that it? That we're just supposed to hang on and just pray for dear life that something changes? Or do we just wallow in it and just think God has forgotten us? That maybe we're being punished for something that we've done? I mean, is that really it? Or does God have a purpose? We know that the enemy has a purpose. He's, you know, consistent. But what about God? Does God have a purpose? You see, the darkness is quite chatty. The darkness wants you to believe that you are forgotten. Nobody cares. You're in this dark time. Nobody cares. Nobody understands. You are in this on your own. God's forgotten you. God's maybe punishing you. You're not like other people. What do you think you've got to contribute? What do you think you've got to give? But what is God's purpose? I want to take you to a scripture that changed my perspective on darkness. And it's found in Isaiah 60, that famous chapter. But not a well-known verse. It says here in Isaiah 60, verse 19, the sun will no more be your light by day, nor will the brightness of the moon shine on you. For the Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Let's read that again. The sun will no more be your light by day, nor will the brightness of the moon shine on you. For the Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Did you know that all of creation is dictated to by the sun by day and the moon by night. The way we all survive, oxygen, you know, food, the tides, the spinning of the planets, everything is dependent on this cycle of night, day, night, day, night, day. In the night we rest, in the day we work, night, day. We don't spend 24 hours working and we don't spend 24 hours sleeping. We have rhythms. Everything is dictated to by those two lights, if you like, or the light by day and the brightness of the moon by night. What this scripture says is that God has a purpose, not just for darkness, but for every single child of His. That you will no longer need the sun to navigate your work life, nor will you need the night to rest, because the Lord is going to be your everlasting light. You will not be dependent on the wind, on the waves, on the cycles, on the tides, on the rhythms that are in the natural, but that God is going to be our everlasting light. I don't know about you, but that excites me. That excites me because God didn't die on a cross. He didn't send His Son to die on a cross to take away the sin of the world, then send His Holy Spirit for us to just live natural lives. But He gave us the Holy Spirit. He gave us salvation. He gave us forgiveness so that we could live supernatural lives. Yet, we all go through dark times. What is God's purpose? Well, let me ask you a question. Have you ever been in a power out where maybe all the electricity is gone? What is the first thing that you do? Do you just, you know, curl up into a ball and go, wow, this is hard. This is really bad. I bet you I'm the only house on the block that's got the lights out. This is not fair. I pay for my electricity and this is not right. No, we don't. What we do in the dark, we have an instinct. It's instinctive. You don't have to be taught it. You don't have to, you know, go and do a course about it. You don't have to read a book about it. It's instinctive. When we're in the dark, we find the light. Most houses have a drawer where there is a torch for such instances as this. Or you've got the cupboard with the candles. I've got a little box that's got full of candles, and then you find the matches. That's what we do. Well, Audacious Church, when you're in the dark, when you go through a suffering, and when you go through trials, and when you go through challenges and pain, when something is in your life that is taking your strength, that is taking your hope, that is taking your joy and making you afraid, number one, look for the light. Just look. What is the light? The Bible says that God is our light. God is light, and in Him there is no darkness. Can I just say that that doesn't mean that He's not in the darkness. It just means that in Him there is no darkness. Can I just say that one thing that we have to know is that God is our light. It also says in the Bible that His Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. You see, one thing that we've got to remember, church, is that God is with us. No matter how bad it is, no matter how painful it is, no matter how shameful it is, no matter how scared you are, no matter how dark it is, and for how long it's been going on, God is with you. 365 times the Bible says, "Fear not, for I am with you." God speaking, fear not, once for every day of the year. Fear not, for I am with you. Why would He say that so many times? Because there's plenty to be afraid of. But He says, not for you, my son, not for you, my daughter, not for you, because I am with you. Psalm 23, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because I'm an idiot? No. Because I'm deluded? No. Because God is with me. I will fear no evil because you are with me. When you're in the dark, find the light. My God is with me. Let's look at Psalm 139, verse 7. It says, the psalmist speaking to God, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, if I make my bed in the darkness, if I make my bed in hell, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, and I have said this, and I'm sure many of us have said this at one time or another, have said, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me. Even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you. That is the psalmist saying that it doesn't matter how dark the situation, darkness, Lord, is as light to you. And the night is as day. Our God does not navigate by day and night, because he is the everlasting light. Can I ask a question? How can the psalmist say that if I make my bed in the depths, you are there? How does he know? Because he's been to the depths. And guess what? God was there. God is with you. It is the first light that you come to. God is with me. You see, in the darkness, church, life gets very simple. In the day, you make plans. In the day, you can see the horizon. In the day, you can figure out what's going on. You can look around your periphery and you can say, okay, this is the climate, this is what's happening, this is the conditions. Yeah, okay, I'm going to make a plan. In the night, you don't have that luxury, you don't have that information. In the dark, you see nothing. So, what do? You find the light, and everything becomes very simple. All you have to do is find Jesus. He is with me. Lord, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. I will fear not because you are with me. And I can be in this darkness if I can know just one thing, that you are with me. That I'm safe in this darkness because you are with me. That you have not abandoned me because you are with me. That you're not punishing me because you are with me. That I haven't been forgotten because you are with me. And then I go the next day. You are with me. Lord, today I know that you are with me. I thank you, Lord, that you are with me. Your hand is on me. And Lord, that's all I know. And then we go the next day. Lord, you are with me. You are with me. And I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your hand. I thank you that you comfort me, that you are with me. And then I go to the next day, and I'm like, you are with me. You are with me. We find the light in the dark. You don't need the light switch. You don't need a new light bulb. You don't need some matches. You need the light of the Word of God. Where is the light, church? It may be this, that, Lord, I know that I am rooted and established in love. Lord, Holy Spirit, teach me how wide, long, high, and deep is the love that you have for me. I am in your love. Wide, long, high, and deep. I am rooted in this love. Lord. Wide, long, high, deep. I am safe in this love. In love you chose me. In love I live. And we keep navigating our path through the darkness in his word. This is the great thing about it, is that you don't have to come up with the answers. You don't have to make it happen. You don't have to look for solutions. You don't have to try and work out, why did I get here? Why is this happening to me? Maybe if I kind of look and I investigate and I read and I da-da-da-da, and you get into your Google self-diagnosis and you get yourself into a bigger mess than you were in the first place. No, in the dark, simple. Find the light. You know, for those who cannot see, When your sight is taken away from you, they say that your hearing is boosted for about 70%. See, God wants you to hear him. We talked about the darkness being chatty, but do you know what that God's speaking to? Listen. It's hard, I know, because the darkness is noisy. But we've got to get into God's presence and listen. Maybe it's just as simple as you are with me. That's all you need to know. Maybe it's as simple as, you know, your love surrounds me, that I'm rooted and established. Maybe it's enough for you that I am blessed with every spiritual blessing. I don't know what it is that you need to hear and what God wants to tell you, but he definitely wants to tell you something in the dark. It doesn't have to be complex. You don't have to get your concordance out. You don't have to like read. No, just listen and let the light of that word light the next step. All you need is the next step. You don't need a 5-year plan. You just need the next step. So church, listen. You see, in the dark, we don't get scared. We get stronger. You see, you didn't realize it. You just thought that you were just hanging on to God's word. You see, you didn't see it. But as you were navigating his word and you were allowing it to light your path and you were just keeping it simple, saying, Lord, I thank you that you are with me, that you are my shepherd, I shall not want, that you lead me, that you refresh my soul, that even if I'm walking through the valley, that I'm not going to fear anything evil because you're with me, and that your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And that you prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You see, you thought that you were just hanging on to Jesus, hanging on to his word. Maybe you felt pathetic. Maybe you felt like you didn't really, you know, like, you know how people think that you're pathetic because you've got faith? Because you can't work out your own problems? Maybe you felt weak. Maybe you felt a little bit like, oh, I just need God. But what you didn't see, because it's almost imperceptible, because the more that you did it, you were getting stronger. The more you did it, your muscles were starting to grow. The more you did it, your legs were starting to get more firm. The more you did it, your posture was changing. And it wasn't looking down anymore, but it's looking up. The more you did it, you started to walk more confidently. The more you did it, the chatter of the darkness started to dim. The more you did it, the word of God started to get a little bit louder, and the voice of God started to get a little bit louder. You got a little bit stronger and stronger and stronger until You no longer resemble the person who went into the darkness. Excuse me. You see, that's why the Bible talks about the sword of the Spirit, because the more we focus on that light, the more we navigate our darkness by the light of God's word from his presence, the more we're starting to get more confident with what God has said, and more confident with who we are, and more confident with who he is, and we start to get trained. You see, there is purpose in the darkness, because it's in the darkness that we get trained, that we get stronger. It's in the darkness, it's in our weakness, it's in our pain, it's in our suffering. When we focus on the light of God's presence and his word, guess what happens? You know, Paul in Corinthians, the apostle Paul, the man Paul, he was, you know, spreading the gospel, blah, 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 doing all the mission stuff, planting churches, doing his thing. But he says in Corinthians, he says, three times I asked for the Lord to take a thorn out of my flesh, something that was causing him pain. We don't know what it was, but it was causing him pain, because I imagine a thorn in your flesh is painful. And the Lord said to him, I'm not going to take it out. He didn't say, oh, poor baby. Well, you're right, this is terrible. No, he said to him, my grace is sufficient for you, because my power is made perfect in your weakness, Paul. Don't tell me to take this away, because it's in this that my power is going to be made perfect in your life. Is there purpose in the darkness? Yes, there is, because it's in that place that God's power is going to rest on you. If you give it to him, if you find him, if you stay with him, if you stay with the truth that he needs to give you, then you will get stronger and stronger and stronger. You'll get more disciplined, more disciplined, more disciplined. You'll get trained. But then that is where God's power is going to rest on you. It's not about your ability, certainly not about your strength. It is not about your charisma, and it's not about your intelligence. It's not about your qualification. It's not about you getting better. It's about you getting stronger in his strength. His power wants to come and rest on your weakness. He wants to come and make that your superpower. This is something I want you to get in your spirits. In the darkness, we don't get scared, we get stronger, we get trained, but also we get ready. Why? Because God's given us a heads up on where he wants to use us. If you're ever wondering, what's my purpose? Look at your weakness. What do you mean? Surely I'll be focusing on my strengths and, you know, allowing God to work with that. Yeah, God can use your strengths, no problem. But it's in your weakness he wants to make you powerful. So what is your purpose? Where's your weakness? Where's the pain? Where's the fear? Where's the shame? Where's the anger? Where's the frustration? Where's the offense? If you give it to God, you journey your dark with his word, his power is going to rest on that. And then you will find out what your spiritual DNA is. Your spiritual DNA. You see, when I was going through sleeplessness, I realized what my weakness was, and that was that I was ashamed. I was ashamed because I felt inadequate. I was ashamed because I felt less than. I was ashamed because I thought, I'm just not good enough. I need to get better. And I was embarrassed. I was ashamed at my inability. I was ashamed at my capacity. But I journeyed it with his word. Thank you, Lord, that you're with me. Your grace is sufficient for me because your power is made perfect in my inability, in my inadequacy, in my lack. That's where you're going to make me powerful. Your grace is sufficient for me. Thank you, God, that I'm chosen. Thank you, God, that I'm adopted. Thank you, God, that it was nothing I deserved, but everything that you have done. I thank you, Lord. Day by day, your grace is sufficient. Day by day, thank you, Lord, that it's by your grace, not about my strength, that your strength. I surrender my ability to your strength. And what I didn't see is that day by day I was getting stronger, day by day I was getting trained, and that day by day, that's where the power of God was coming to rest. You see, Abraham was fatherless. He wasn't fatherless. He was no father. He didn't have children, not a dad. What did God say to him? Well, let's work with what you do have. You got a wife? You got some cows? No, that's not where the promise was. That wasn't where the power was. That wasn't where the supernatural was. That wasn't where the Holy Spirit was. No, Abraham, I'm going to make you the father of nations. The very thing that you thought was your weakness. The very thought that you thought was your shame. I'm going to put my power on it, and I'm going to make it your superpower. What does Jesus do? He goes to the blind man and he says, well, you've got your other senses. Let's work with what you've got. No, he says to the blind man, what do you want me to do? He says, I want to see in the very thing that was your weakness, in the very thing that separated you and ostracized you from the rest of the community, in the very thing that was your shame, in the very thing that kept you contained and quiet and less than living a substandard, subhuman life, in that very thing, I'm going to put my power on you and I'm going to help you to see. That is where God wants to put his power, and that is why you're going through the darkness. It's purpose. It's you're like superheroes. Before they know that they're a superhero and they've got some superpowers, most of the time, I can't be certain for every situation because I'm not that knowledgeable on every superpower person story. But the ones that I've seen, if we look at it, when you look at a super person who is yet to find their powers, manifest their powers, it's always in a situation of high pressure, high fear, high pain. There is something that they go through and it manifests this power. You have a spiritual design. You have a God design. Bible says that God knew you even before you were born. That God knew you and set you apart to have a place to play in his plans. The only way you're going to find where that power is by going through the darkness with his word. God does not want you to be afraid, and he does not want you to be contained, and he does not want you to be angry, and he doesn't want you to be frustrated, and he doesn't want you to be ashamed, and he doesn't want you to be offended. He wants you to be free. But you're going to have to do the work. Stop saying, why me? Ain't going to happen. Boy, in fact, let me answer that right now. God thinks so much of you that he's allowing you to go through this so you could find his power. Men, you must have an incredible purpose. What God wants to do in and through your life must be massive if he's allowing you to go through this suffering, if he's allowing you to go through this pain. He wants you to find his power, because then you'll be a light to somebody else. Jesus said, you are the light of the world. How do you get that light? Well, it's by walking through the darkness, finding the light, getting stronger, getting trained. Let me just finish, because I love this and I don't want you to miss it. Jesus said in John 12, anyone who loves their life will lose it. Anyone who hates their life in the world will keep it for eternal life. That sounds painful. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also must be, will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. But I love this about Jesus. He just lays that whole thing out, and then he says, but now my soul is troubled. I'm walking in a dark place, because he knows what he has to face. He knows the kind of death he's about to die. He knows about the betrayal of his friends. He knows that he's taken the sin of the world upon his own body. And he says, my soul is troubled. And he says, but what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? You know, he could have bailed. He could have said, not doing it. He says, but no, it was for this very reason, for this very dark place that I am now in. This is why I came. I came here so that, Father, that you will glorify your name. How many times do we say, Father, save me from this hour. Father, save me from this hour. That we don't even realize that the purpose for this hour is for God's power to come and rest on us. For us not to navigate by the sun or the moon, but to navigate by his everlasting light that never changes. It doesn't matter what the circumstances are. He does not change. And he is always with us. And his power is always available to us. So what is your weakness? Flip it. What is your shame? Flip it. What's the opposite? Flip it. Because right there, you've got a heads up. You've got a window into what God wants to anoint, what God wants to empower, what God wants to train, what God will use. Your pit will become your platform. God will use it. God will use it not for your happiness, not for anything like that, but for his glory. Because it's always been about his glory. We don't become Christians because we want an easy life. We become Christians because there is no other life but to serve him and to glorify his name. And that means walking through the darkness. But there's purpose. When people come to me and they say, well, this is what I'm walking through, and it's hard, it's tough, I can't help but get excited. Not because I'm a masochist, sadist, which is the one that you pain for other people. Sadist. It's not because I'm a sadist. It's because I'm like, whoa, I can see what God's going to do. I can see your spiritual DNA. You've got addiction problems. When God flips it, and you find him in the darkness through that light, and you walk daily and daily and daily and daily and daily. That very passion, that very deep down need becomes a deep down need for him. Just flip it. I want to pray for some people in this place that you're going through a dark time. In the dark, we don't get scared. We find the light. We listen. Listen to his voice. We get trained. And then we allow our weakness to become our superpower by his Spirit. You know, when people are born blind, their hearing becomes like a superpower, and that's what God wants to do. He wants to make the very thing that is hard where you're powerful.